have a good astronomy colloquium for this for today. It's a great pleasure and honor to have John Wise here as our colloquium speaker and guest. John did his PhD at Stanford University with Tom Abel in 2007, and then moved as a postdoctoral fellow, NASA fellow, to Goddard Space Flight Center, and later in 2009 as a Hubble fellow to Princeton University. And since 2011, he's a professor at the Center for Relativistic Astrophysics at Georgia Institute of Technology. He's the Dunn Family Professor since 2015. So we're very looking forward to talk on simulated cosmic dawn predictions for JWST. So let's welcome him to Hagrid.
So we'll be going on a journey looking at the formation of the first stars in the whole universe and how that actually affects the first generations of galaxies, which I show here on the right. So since the CRA at Georgia Tech is a relatively new center, I always like to remind places where it is. Where is Georgia Tech? Because I actually am an alumni and my hometown is Atlanta, so it's right in the middle of Atlanta, because I get this question all the time. So just to remind people, here's town, good times there, but here's our American football stadium. Okay, so enough of that, but on to the outline of what I want to talk about in the next 50 minutes. First, because I like history, and I think we can learn a lot to understand what our previous generations of astronomers actually studied, and looking at, you know, how the background was actually built up and in the formation of first stars. And the first stars is the main question, I think, is what is the initial mass function? Because that determines a lot. How many black holes you'll form, how many metals, how many supernovas you'll form, and this all goes into the first galaxies. And what can we learn from both the high redshift observations from the extreme deep field from Hubble, and from near field cosmology from the local dwarfs around us? And then I'll finish up by looking at showing two simulation suites, one that I would term perfect galaxy simulations and the Renaissance simulations. What I'll be showing you scaling relationships, what kind of physical properties are actually expected in these halos, in these first generations of galaxies, and which are being observed right now in the frontier fields. And James Webb will discover even dimmer and fainter galaxies in 2 or 3 years. So it's very exciting to actually prepare for JWST to actually launch in just over 2 years. Okay, so I always like, since this is a cosmology talk, so we show the, so it's always best to show the cosmic timeline. So, you know, after recombination, we have a very dark universe. Dark ages actually start. And at this point, you have some dark matter halos starting to form. The smallest dark matter halos in the CDM paradigm are Earth mass, and those continuously merge together and form larger and larger halos. But they're still too small to actually host luminous structure formation. You have no stars, it's basically dark. But at some point, around redshift 20 or 30 or so, you start to light up, and you can actually cool the gas sufficiently to actually condense and form the first stars. And what's shown here in yellow, these are like a representation of these H2 regions being formed around the first stars, and then the first galaxies. As they merge together and form larger and larger galaxies, so here's a schematic of these mergers happening. The first star is actually occurring in dark matter halos around a million solar masses, redshift 20 or so, but it is happening continuously. And these merge together to form a first galaxy in a dark matter halo around 10 to the 8 solar masses. So I flipped it because I'm taking someone else, two people's renditions of this cosmic timeline in this figure from Volker Brahms and Naoki Yoshida's review on the first galaxies. So you do what you have to do. And then these two regions grow, they percolate, they combine together, and eventually we have the epoch of ionization. And then the universe becomes transparent to these ionizing photons, and we start to see galaxy formation in full force. Right? It peaks at redshift 2, the star formation rate density, and all these photons from all these galaxies forming over cosmic time streams toward us on Earth. And this is what we see. We see the Hubble extreme deep field. We can zoom around. I'm sure that everyone's seen this before, it's just nice to take this 6,000 pixel image across and actually just pan around and look at the different morphologies, the colors, the different sizes of these galaxies, right? Because this is what we have to work with to form a theory of galaxy formation, starting from the first stars, the first generation of galaxies, to what we can actually observe and the extreme deep field, right? So we can take these data and create things like color diagrams, luminosity functions. We can compute from the luminosity functions what kind of stellar mass corresponds to a halo mass, and so on. But if we really want to study the first generation of galaxies, they're actually smudges. I mean, it's very exciting to actually see photons from these very high redshift galaxies. I mean, there has been one that's like a few months ago from Pascal Roche that had a redshift of 11. That's spectroscopically confirmed. But I mean, we're seeing these photons from these first generation of galaxies only a half a billion years after the Big Bang. So this is really the observational motivation for our work that we do in my group and my collaborators in various institutions. So how do we actually take the information that's contained in the photometry and, if we're lucky, the spectra of these galaxies, and what can we learn about their star formation histories and their connection to the even earlier networks, right? All in preparation for James Webb and 30-meter telescopes. So this is, to actually understand first stars, I always like to step back and ask basic questions. So we can look at all the stars in the Milky Way, all the stars in the halo, dwarf galaxies, and we see all the stars contain those. We know this. Right? But why do all the stars contain those? So the earliest reference I could actually find that posed this question was Martin Schwarzschild and Spitzer. So they actually saw that. You saw a very low abundance of metals and two stars. You had a lot of white dwarfs, and you had red and dead galaxies, right? And this, they interpreted this, that the original stellar population 2 contained a large number of relatively massive stars. Right? I think that was quite amazing. This was over 63 years ago, where this was like the population, probably the first reference to massive stars in the early universe. So a decade later, it started to, people started, all the pieces of the puzzle, they weren't really connected, but for star formation to actually occur at these high redshifts without metals, how does it actually happen? Because if we look in the present day, H2 can actually cool, can form on dust grains on the surface of the dust grains, but if you have no metals, you have no dust, how can you form H2? You have to do it in the gas phase. And this is primarily done through this catalyst of a free electron. If you have free electrons, this can attach and form H-, which then interacts with a hydrogen atom, then on to form H2. So in that H2, then you can actually get cooling from rotational and vibrational modes in that molecule. So this can cool you down to a few hundred Kelvin. So this was actually, these reaction rates were taken by Suslaw and Zipwood in their Nature paper in 1967, and they found that you would have to need a few thousand Kelvin to produce enough free electrons, and this would instigate cooling through H2, which then can cool you down to a few hundred Kelvin. So if you need a few thousand Kelvin to produce these free electrons to cool the gas and form stars, where does this actually happen? So you can pose the question, when and where did the first stars form? So if you need gas that's a few thousand Kelvin, you can think about that happening as dark matter halos virializing and the gas shock heats to the virial temperature. So that a few thousand Kelvin, a thousand Kelvin or so, corresponds to dark matter mass of 100,000 solar masses. And those typically first start forming using Kreis-Schechter formalism around the redshift 20 or 30. So this is first realized by Hugh Kaufman and Martin Reason 30 years ago. Right? And also a decade later, Max Tegmark and his collaborators actually determined a redshift-dependent minimum halo mass instead of just this order of magnitude estimate here. But I like this plot that they had in the paper. It's basically showing for some temperature what you actually get after a Hubble time of cooling. What is the H2 fraction that you get after cooling for a Hubble time at various redshifts? Right, here's 100, redshift 100, 50, and 25. and what you actually need, what kind of HT fraction do you actually need to actually cool, and what's the cooling time, when you set the cooling time to the Hall time, and what HT fraction you actually need, and where these two lines intersect. It gives you what is the minimum halo virial temperature of the halo to actually cool. So if we just take, like, these are unrealistic, 150, but if we take this pressure 25, it's around 2,000 Kelvin or so, and that corresponds to around 10 to the 5. And you can just imagine this progressively gets larger and larger as H2 takes longer to form. I mean, this was a simple model, but still it gives us a sense of what were the halo masses in which these first stars start to form. So this all gave the theoretical basis for simulations to actually explore three-dimensional cosmological simulations of first star formation. So there are two independent groups that were actually doing this at the same time, one led by Robert Brown and Tom Hale around the turn of the century. So they found, I mean, there's some things that they reproduced, like the gas cooled down to a few hundred kelvins for each tipping, but then you could actually study accretion rates into the central core. They didn't exactly form the star, but you can look at turbulent motions in the molecular cloud, and basically, like, this temperature characterizes the genes mass of that inner cloud of around 1,000 degrees. And in these early studies, they didn't see any fragmentation. So that led us to believe that you had one star per halo, one single massive star per halo. That was, you know, tens of solar masses, even. I mean, this is the order of magnitude estimate provided by Tom Abel, 30 to 300. I mean, basically, there's a huge uncertainty range. And the chemistry models were continually being improved to push to higher and higher densities over the years. So here's a figure from Ida Yoshida's paper in 2008. So here's a whole cosmological halo. It's a few times 10, or several times 10 to the 5 solar masses. And we just zoom in. So this is 300 parsecs across, 55 parsecs across. This is where the star is actually forming, and it's falling in. And we look at zooming in even to 10 AU. So this is the fully molecular part. You see these bars forming. I wouldn't pay much attention to that yet. And finally, I mean, I think this was the first time that in 3D that the protostellar shock was actually observed and was simulated. And they reached densities up to 10 to the 18 particles per cubic centimeter, or 10 to the 19 particles per cubic centimeter here. So this problem has a huge dynamical range, both in density and mass. So it's a difficult problem. But there is a kind of a, I don't want to say paradigm change, but just a change of thinking from these single points that are forming single stars to binary and multiple star formation rates, or star forming regions. So one of the first simulations to actually see this was Matt Turk's work. This is a large scale thermal fragmentation at large scales that's separated by about 1,000 AU. So there are two comps that actually fragment at these scales, at these densities, and this has a mass of 6 solar masses and 10 solar masses. But they're still accreting at a very high rate. So this showed that you can have binaries at these at large separations. And I think this is a result of just more integration time, because the early studies were just studying, like, the first point that was actually plotted. Another study was by Thomas Greif, who he studied at very, you know, higher densities, looking at disk fragmentation. So imagine that those initial studies, you know, this is where they stop. So each row represents one mini halo, and if we go left to right, that's evolving time. So all the previous studies, they're basically stopping here. They look at the first point, but not really evolving the system, seeing how accretion disks form around the central point, and seeing how the comps and fragmentation actually occurred in the disk. So you can see here that you get fragmentation in every one of these cases. And whether they merge or not, how many comps actually survive, what fraction are actually ejected, what is IMF, I think that's still up for question. I mean, it's still unclear. If we have low mass stars that can survive until present day, I mean, what if we just haven't detected a metal poor star? Or metal free star, sorry. Or what if we have a metal free star that has accreted some small amount of the ISM and is being masked by this accreted material? I mean, they may be hiding in plain sight, but you know, most metal ore star that's ever been observed is, for iron, it's 10 to the minus 7, but for all metals, it's around 10 to the minus 5 of solar metallicity. So this is all good and well, looking at fragmentation, but to actually address the problem of the IMF of the first stars, we need to include protostellar feedback. So here's some work done by a Japanese group that's led by Hosokawa. So originally they had just one axisymmetric 2.5D simulation where they extracted this from a cosmological halo, and they looked at the accretion onto the sinkhole as a group and had ionizing radiation going up. And you see these bipolar H2 regions here, so you have temperature on the left and they have density on the right. And this is going on for about 70,000 years. So originally it accretes to around 40 solar masses. I mean, this is still 2D, it's axisymmetric, it's ignoring its disk fragmentation, so there's still work to be done to actually understand what is the exact IMF of population three stars. And in this, so this is a 2D simulation, and recently they progressed to 3D simulation, still in spherical symmetry, but it's in advanced. So this dashed line here is without any feedback, and this solid line here is with ionizing and dissociation feedback. But the point to take away is that it really suppresses any accretion, as expected, but you still get a massive star. Whether this has companions or secondary stars is still for debate. And they actually did this for a whole cosmological box, where they extracted 1,540 halos and simulated all these. I think this is a heroic effort by a graduate student, Hirano, still, this is a caveat of being a 2.5D simulation, but you get this, they see this IMF here. So you have one hump here that's basically affected by ionizing photons these are what's called, but population 3.2. It's things that are forming in ionized regions where you have elevated free electrons from relative H2 regions. And this big hump here is actually forming in more typical neutral regions that are unaffected by nearby stars. And this red hump here are halos that are being dissociated heavily by nearby sources. So I think the thing to take away, I wouldn't take this shape exactly, but it's still pointing toward massive stars forming, being the prevalent mass in metal-free stars. So if we know they're massive, they must have a destructive influence on their surroundings. So this leads me to the next part of my talk after going on the formation of the first stars about how their radiation actually heats and photoionizes the surrounding neighborhood. So to do this, you first need a spectrum. So in 2000, Jason Tomlinson, he actually produced these stellar models for both 15 solar mass stars, and there are other studies as well, but I did like how he compared these two spectra. You see, because you have a lot of opacity in metals, even though this star has a metallicity of around a 20th of solar, and it has, you know, has a fair amount of UV, but if you compare it to a metal-free star, because the only opacity that flows here is through electron scattering. And because of that, you get this nearly mass-independent surface temperature of around 10 to the 5. You have a 10 to the 5 Kelvin surface temperature, you're going to have a lot of UV photons and ionize the surrounding regions. Right, so we can take these ionizing luminosities and actually use these in simulations. So first, the easiest thing to do, of course, is 1D simulations, spherically symmetric simulations, where they actually took these radially averaged profiles from cosmological simulations, stuck at a source in the very center, and saw how this ionization front expanded and broke out from this cosmological halo. Now this is great to understand, you know, how many photons actually escape into the IGM, how quickly does it break out, and how much gas does it blow out of the gas of the actual halo. Because these ionization fronts, they can actually drive a shockwave once it's coupled to the gas itself once the ionization rate is, or ionization front velocity actually declines to the sound speed, you can actually drive this shockwave at around 30 kilometers per second. And because remember that these first stars are contained in many halos, so halos around a million solar masses, their escape velocities are a few kilometers per second. So they easily drive out all the gas from their host halo. And then a few years later, this progressed to 3D simulations where we found the same thing happening, that you leave behind a warm ISM and it's diffuse, but we started to see 3D effects. So I just want to plot here because it creates butterfly-shaped H2 region, and we'll see why. So this is a simulation I did as a PhD student. It's getting quite old now. So here's a dark matter halo. A million solar masses, it has two cores because it had just merged, right? But we just went with it and saw the effects of the radiation on this. And this is projected density and projected temperature. And it's around 1 kiloparsec proper across. So each star is 100 solar masses, has no supernova. You can see the ionization front breaking out, and it only lives for a few million years because it's so massive. We have 100 solar mass stars here. But this dense core survives, it goes through the main sequence, and it expels even more gas. But this is all occurring before any first galaxies form. So this is like one piece of the puzzle that we need to consider in forming realistic first generations of galaxies. Because inherently, if you had your progenitors being gas poor like this and enriched by some supernova, rather than being gas rich like so, if you had no star formation, you would have a lot, if you were gas rich like this, you would have a lot more fuel for star formation than those first galaxies. Right? But the thing to take away from this is it drives out all the gas. And even more destructive are, what if these stars actually produce supernovae? Regular type 2 supernovae, hypernovae, and something special, parasimilar supernovae. So these only occur in metal-free stars. They're very unique to this population 3. They roughly occur in this mass range here. Actually, I take these from a non-rotating stellar model. They've been updated with rotating models. But basically, I mean, the whole helium core is converted to metals. There's no stellar remnant left behind compared to like a type 2 supernova that puts behind a few solar masses of metals at most. Right? And you're at most, and the maximum metal ejected is around 80 solar masses. So there's a tremendous, if this happens, if we have some stars being produced in this mass range, we'll have a tremendous amount of metals going out into the IGM. And they have a very, very peculiar abundance pattern, much different than the type 2 supernova. And this has been used to actually search for traces of enrichment from these pairs of those supernovae. And this all goes back to what is the high myth? Because we need to know how many of these stars actually produce supernovae, and the other fraction will actually produce black holes. So this is like, a lot of people show this plot from Alex Haggard from 2003, so this is basically, we focus just on the low y-axis here. So basically this is a function of metallicity, similar endpoints is a function of metallicity and the initial mass. So for metal-free stars, we have basically our supernova in between 80 and 40 solar masses, you get a direct collapse into a black hole, you get just a remnant, and not that much, no explosion at all. And you get these pairs of those supernovae in this mass range here, 140 to 216. Those mass ranges are fuzzy. And above this, you get black holes as well. So if you imagine that you convolve your IMF with your stellar endpoints, you get some fraction going into supernova and some fraction in black holes. And if you have even low mass stars below this, you have AGB stars that can actually enrich the gas, provide winds to the galaxies, and so on. So, on the topic of chemical enrichment, these first stars, the supernova first stars that actually enrich the progenitors of the first galaxies and enrich the IGM, which then falls back into the halo to form the first metal enriched stars. And this is some work that I did with Bert Smith, who led this project. The enrichment of an external enrichment of a mini halo. So here we're following the formation of one of the first stars in the simulation. Here his temperature here, you'll see that these two regions grow very rapidly because it lives so shortly, and then we switch over to metallicity. Right, here's the blast wave going off, the halo has been completely obliterated. And you see these fingers starting to form from radiative halo instabilities. But that doesn't really enrich these surrounding halos before another star forms up here. So I made this beautiful movie. I can't take credit for making this movie. Burton Smith made it. And then we have the second star forming. You can see the blast wave cools and condenses and creates this dead shell, but there's this satellite galaxy that was around 500 parsecs away. It wasn't totally photoevaporated, and the metals mix in to a level around 2×10⁻⁵ solar. And this happens, I mean, if we think about what is the typical metallicity of the IGM from one blast wave, it's around 10⁻³ of a metallicity floor or so. But if we were to, but we see stars below this metallicity floor, 10⁻³ or 10⁻⁴. And it occurs because we have incomplete mixing of these metals. If you think about a blast wave overpassing a dense cloud, you're going to have some mixing into the smallest radii, mainly through turbulence. So here, at the small scales, the metallicity has pretty much been locked out because that central point, the free fall time is much smaller than the mixing time scale that we see. And we see some level of fragmentation before we stop the simulation because we don't have a good prescription for protostellar feedback for same particles. So we just compared what were the results of fragmentation based on if we had dust cooling or if we did not have dust cooling. And this occurs on expected densities around 10⁻¹ⁱ grams per cubic centimeter, or around 10⁻¹³ or 10⁻¹² particles per cc. Okay, so what I was talking about with all the different fractions of stars going into that have supernovae, the other fraction having black holes. So these actually enrich the progenitors of the first star. So this is a function, this is the metallicity from population 3 stars as a function of halo mass. So at the smallest halo mass, you see a large spread, you see a dichotomy of enrichment. So we have dark matter halos that are not enriched at all. Right? These are just 25% and 75% percentiles here. So there are some halos that are enriched, just to some level, but there are some halos that are not enriched at all. So this goes all the way down to negative infinity in the log scale. But once you reach a certain point, around a few times 10⁻³ or so, all of the halos that we see in our simulation have been enriched from population 3 stars. So this sets a scale for when we actually start to transition to metal-enriched star formation, in which that will be the last half of my talk. Now I want to spend a few minutes on some of the work that one of my graduate students has been doing. He's graduating about a year from now, applying for jobs in the fall. And he's been looking at how do magnetic fields actually grow in these supernovae. So what he's done is he's taken a radiation MHD simulation and actually studied it. We don't have any injection sites on it. We don't consider injection of magnetic fields on dynamos, but once the blast wave actually forms, how do the magnetic fields behave? How do they grow as this blast wave propagates into the IGM? So what he did was he considered one population, 3 star, 40 solar masses, and just a regular quark cloud supernova, typical 10⁵ hertz of energy. So this is what he found. So here's the density production, and this is magnetic energy. So here's the H2 region, it's blowing all the gas out, and there's a supernova that goes off. It's not that hard to see. I'll show a better figure here, but if I go to the very end, once it can radiatively cool and condense, it's different, but I'll show a better plot of this, but the magnetic energy, the magnetic field grows through vorticity. Right? This is how the magnetic fields are amplified once it can cool and condense. So you can see once it can enter the snowplow phase of the supernova, you can see just the vorticity increases greatly. Here it is, and it just becomes opaque in this color scale here. Well, we can actually compare it at the time of star formation, right during, right after the supernova. You can see this hot ball here still, the spherical is still in the Steinel Taylor phase, and here it is 2 million years after the supernova. So here's the density field is fragmenting, it's cooled down to a few thousand degrees, and here's the vorticity here, you can see it's much higher than here. And if we compare what is this amplification in the shell here compared to what was here before, it's on the order of, there's some distribution, but it's on the order, the mean is on the order of 100 or so in the supernova shell. So this is pretty much aiming to understand how were the primordial magnetic fields actually amplified at first, and what is the filling fraction of these magnetic fields in the high chain? Because this should be occurring everywhere in the universe at these early times. Okay, so moving on to the first galaxies. Now that we looked at the effects of the first stars, the radiative feedback, the supernova feedback, how this all plays into the first galaxies, the first generation of galaxies. But we can still use not only the most distant observations of galaxies, but the galaxies in our own backyard, local dwarfs. Because some of these, all of these have some star formation at before reionization. There's been some great work recently looking at star formation histories of all the dwarf galaxies. The name is different. But you can look at this metallicity-luminosity relationship here, and you can see that there's a nice relationship in between luminosity and metallicity. So we can ask ourselves, where do these metals originate in these dwarf galaxies? Do they originate from some pre-enrichment, or are they produced inside of it? I mean, obviously, you have star formation inside of the galaxy, but at what level does some pre-enrichment actually occur? The lowest metallicities. Do they come from population 3 stars, or do they originate in situ? And also, not only can we use the mean stellar metallicities, but we can use the metallicity distribution function in these dwarf galaxies. Because if we look at the first galaxies and try to make a comparison with the local dwarfs, there's a lot happening in 13 billion years, of course. But one thing that is actually locked in are these metallicity. Like, once a star has a metallicity, it's locked in, right? The dynamics might change, the mass will change over billions of years. But once these ancient stars have their metallicity, they're there until the present day for these low mass stars. So this can serve as some constraint on our high redshift simulations. We basically don't want a dwarf galaxy to have solar metallicity. This has been known for a while, the overcooling problem, where you just overproduce stars, you have too much cooling, you produce too much metals, it's a runaway effect. And we try to use this as a check against this. So what do we actually try to accomplish with these? What do we want to know about these first galaxies, and how do we do it? So there's a couple things that we want to study. We want to study one high redshift galaxy that has a host halo mass of around 10 to the 9 solar masses. This should host a galaxy around a million solar masses and stars. But we also want to capture the full star formation history, right? All the way from the first generation of stars to this mass, to this galaxy. And so we need to use small boxes, we need to use AMR, and we also want to make the connection in between these first galaxies and the first stars. We have to have distinct modes of pop 2 star formation and pop 3 star formation. And because they're very small halos, they're very susceptible to feedback, right? They're shallow potential wells, it's easy to drive off those. So we have to have accurate prescriptions of radiation feedback and supernova feedback. And also, I made this plot for a proposal. It's not that accurate, but the proposal was denied. So. But anyways, so here is basically what can be observed by HST. This is by redshift and halo mass and stellar mass, and what could be observed by HST. And what has been done, these are just individual simulations that have been done, what has been done that captures both these population 3 stars and the first galaxies. So the goal is to actually match these, right? I mean, the observations are going to lower and lower stellar masses, and the simulation is growing from larger and larger galaxies while still capturing population 3 stars. So here's one example of one of my simulations that I just described. It's a 1 megaparsec box that looks at the transition from the first stars to to the first galaxies. So this is actually a planetarium show narrated by not only the Benedict Cumberbatch. That was pretty awesome seeing his, hearing his voice over high simulation. So we can go ahead, and so blue is cold and neutral, but here are all these H2 regions forming, and they quickly recombine. I mean, because the recombination rates are very high at these times, and these stars only live for a few million years. So they're like fireworks going off all over the universe. But eventually, I mean, these give its way to galaxy formation. They enrich the surrounding regions, and halos become massive enough to actually host galaxies. So the first galaxy that to actually undergo continuous star formation is actually going to form, there's a dot right there, and it starts to just grow, this H2 region grows, there's outflows coming out here in blue. But we can take a closer look at this. So this is this top graph here. So I don't have time to go over both of these, but here's this projected density. It's a very irregular galaxy. It undergoes many, many mergers. Here's its projected temperature. And this is its metallicity. It's basically my attempt at showing both population metals from pop 3 stars, which are blue and red, and metals from pop 2 stars. Mix them together and get magenta, right? So if it's fully mixed, you have no metal-free pockets of gas in these halos, because you have turbulence. You have turbulence that's been generated by virilization of these halos by mergers, and it fully mixes these all the way down to a resolution limit of these halos. And if it actually is from a pillar of turbulence, you can expect that it also mix down to an inertial scale. Okay, so here's a movie of the density, temperature, and metallicity of this most massive halo. So you see many of these mini halos forming stars, creating these H2 regions, and also enriching the surrounding regions. So I'll play that again. So you can see, once it forms a star, its halo, its gas is totally blown out, and it heats up, photoionizes the surrounding IGM, and it enriches the IGM, but these metals can only go so far other and then fall back in because of the local bubble flow. It's all falling back into this large-scale potential bubble. And here's, you can see at the very end, they started to create these outflows from metal-enriched stars. So from this, we can actually reconstruct a star formation history. So this is the star formation history function of time, and it's metallicity. Each one of these dots is a star particle in your simulation. The size of these points are proportional to the mass. So this is the size of a 1,000 solar mass star particle and a 10,000 solar mass star particle. But there are, at early times, you have a large range of metallicities. This is because those stars are forming into progenitor stars. They're not connected to each other. Right? They're enriched by other pop 3 stars, but they're forming not in this main halo here, but in this progenitor. So the thing that I always try to stress is the most metal poor star is not always the oldest star. Right? Because you can have a whole range here. I mean, I want to dispute that a metal poor star is ancient, right? But it's not the oldest star in the universe. But it does have that intimate connection to, say, the initial generation of stars. But once you get some star formation going on, you steadily enrich the ISM, and then the stars form. So these lines here, these are individual stellar populations that have then merged and formed next century from this galaxy and then merged in. So if you were watching a movie of this going in time, these would just pop in as they move into the viral radius. And you can project this star formation history in both axes. You get your metallicity distribution function. This is peculiar. I won't take this away, but this is a bimodal distribution that primarily occurs from this merger here. I think it's a transient, it'll go away once you start to form more stars here. And here's the star formation rate. So we're still very low, like a 10 to the minus 2 solar masses per year. And we can look at all these properties. We can look at the global properties of these first galaxies as a function of halo mass. So I show a lot of things here. This is a pretty busy plot, but this is a function of halo mass and the stellar mass. So we have inefficient star formation rate, where we can't actually cool through atomic line transitions. We have to rely on fine structure lines to cool temperatures. And this results in inefficient star formation. So we get on the level of open star cluster, 10,000 solar masses. atoms and starts forming in these first galaxies. But once he transitioned into these atomic coolers, these halos that can actually cool by atomic line transitions, its star formation rate greatly increases. So here's a star formation rate here. So it's very small. These smallest galaxies, it's, you know, just over 10 to the minus 4 solar mass per year, but then it jumps up and it'll go out like that, looking at larger galaxies. And they're extremely dim. I mean, these will probably never be observed, and I hope by the end of my lifetime, maybe, you know, minus 10, maybe, but because, well, I'll show this later, but with gravitational lensing, maybe we can get down to like minus 13, minus 14 with James Webb, and so they're very dim. And this is why I think it's also important to look at the near field at these dwarf galaxies, because some constraints. So these properties can be used in large scales. That's one of my motivations, is how do these galaxies actually contribute to reionization? So this is a beautiful animation and simulation that was done by Marshall Alvarez of reionization. So this is blue is ionized and hot, and you can see just how these H2 regions grow. But to model this, what's actually needed are the stellar masses, the stellar mass halo mass relationship, and how many of these UV photons that are emitted by massive stars, how many of those actually escape in the IGM to create these cosmological H2 regions. So this is one getting parsec across. This is tuned to radionize at much of 6.5 or so. But you can see how it accelerates and becomes more and more transparent. It's very slow to start, but then it rapidly becomes transparent to ionizing radiation. These yellow dots are where the halos are. So, I mean, this is a notoriously difficult property to both observe in galaxies and to simulate. Because you need accurate simulation of radiation transfer to actually get those ionized channels to see how those ionization fronts break out into IGM. So, I think only focus on this top one here. So, this is how the escape fraction of these UV photons vary with halo mass here. So there's a large spread at low halo masses, at around, it has a median of around a half, but I mean, because star formation it actually occurs in these low mass halos, they're very bursty. Basically, at these low masses, you can condense one time and form one stellar cluster, but once you form that one stellar cluster, it's going to blow out all the gas. And you're going to have a kind of delay in between that first metal-rich star formation event to the next one. And once you collect more and more gas, it becomes more and more difficult, actually, for these UV photons to actually escape. And the more massive halos, we see on the order of like 5 to 10% escape. But this was, I think, was a surprise. Other people have suggested that low-mass galaxies could have high escape fractions, because it's in the shallow potential well, you can drive out flows. It's very easy for the photons to actually escape, to ionize certain channels of the ISO. So it's highly time varying. So this is a movie of the most massive galaxy in our simulation of the Dead Sea and the UV flux. So over 80 million years. So you can see how dynamic the ISM is and how much these channels of UV flux are varying in time and angle. Right, we have some, just a bump in the star, it's not a star burst, right? It's only an increase of factor 2 in star formation rate, but that produces a huge jump in escape fraction during that time from, you know, 1% all the way up to 12%. And once those massive stars die, then it goes back down to a few percent. So this is usually when I say that these first galaxies are very important in understanding what is the photon budget and reionization. But last Wednesday night for me, this came out, right? The Planck paper that placed more constraints on the optimal depth of Thomson scattering. So this is an integral measure of when does reionization actually occur. So this is a progression of, you know, the 3-year WMAP data where it was 0.09. This is a reionization of around 12, if I remember right. And it gradually goes down. Here's the first Planck measurement. Which one is it? This one here. And now it's slowly going down. Last year, when they actually combined the Planck data, 0.056, now it's 0.055. So that means that if you consider instantaneous reionization, if you go from neutral to ionous instantaneously, that means you have a reionization epoch of around 8.2, if I remember right from the paper. And also that says that reionization actually occurs on a very rapid time scale. I think what they quoted in the paper was delta Z of 2.5 or so. So I think we have to revisit what actually goes into reionization, like what are the escape fractions, if we have any X-rays that from proto-AGN or X-ray binaries that contribute to partial ionization on AGM, and so on, right? Or well, next year will it go back? I don't know. It's always this general trend here. Okay, I think I have about 10 more minutes or so. So move on to what we call the Renaissance simulation. So I think the downfall of that small box, right? We have a limited number of galaxies forming. We only have like 32 galaxies forming, and we don't have many large scale modes that we can actually look at. So we took a larger box, 40 million parsecs, and looked at three zoom-in regions, what we call rare peak, a mean region of the void. And we had not as great mass resolution of 29 solar masses, but our spatial resolution was around, you know, two proper parsecs. In the most mass part, the rarest peak here, we actually followed the formation of over 13,000 population three stars. And the other simulation that showed there was around 300. So this is like two orders of magnitude greater in complication. And we have 1,000 dwarf galaxies forming. So this is the whole box that runs with 8. This is dark matter running an exploratory run. Here's the rare peak, and it forms five times 10 to the 10 solar mass halo, which is 6. This is the normal region. It looks more dense, but it's just a convection effect. It's a main region in the universe. And here's the void region that is handled. And I just got this Monday, this movie that NCSA made for us. So this is flying through the rare peak at NRSO 15. So white is the UV flux, red is ionized. So you can see this is the very earliest times of reionization. This is the volume field fraction of ionized gas is only 3% at this time, average of 15, even in this very overdense region. So I believe like the whole zoom-in region was around 6 co-moving parsecs. If I look at this, it probably started like 4 co-moving parsecs across. And it's basically flying into I've watched it open twice. So I think we're going to this galaxy here. So it shows that, you know, we still have the H2 regions that are still contained in very small regions, but locally it's very important to understand how this ionization actually affects the local properties of galaxies. And because to understand reionization, you have to understand how the galaxy properties behave as a halo mass, and to understand galaxies, we have to understand star formation. So it depends, and all the way down. And ultimately, when we have subgrid models, all galaxy simulations have subgrid models, so we depend on, you know, star formation simulations in the local, not the local waveform, but localized, isolated, idealized star formation simulations to actually understand how the star formation occur on the parsec or sub-parsec levels. So here are some projections of density and these glyphs here. So if I start over here, the red actually indicate the galaxies that are observable by Hubble right now, which is 8. So this is around 1.5 arc minutes across. This is almost the size. This is slightly smaller than the field of view of NIRCam on James Webb. So this is looking at the void region, and blue are galaxies detectable by JWST. With considering a 10 to the 5 second exposure, and if we use like one of the frontier fields, if we use 10 times magnification, you could detect these galaxies, the green points here, and all the way out to the redshift of 15. This is how they overlay with the ionized fraction here in blue. And we can take all these galaxies and create luminosity functions. And so in blue, I show what is like the mean region, right? This is are many groups that look at this, but we just picked, for example, Bridget Bowens and Steve Finkelstein for that. But we still see a power law here, and then it turns over at around absolute magnitude of minus 12 and above. And our mass resolution probably, I wouldn't trust anything dimmer than minus 6 or so. Because basically, that's one star, right? One massive star is minus 6. But how we get these very dim luminosities are if we have an evolved star particle, right? If you actually form a few star particles, you have a stellar cluster that has a few solar masses, but it's all the massive stars that died, and you lost all UV light. This is how we get these low luminosities or high magnitudes. And this purple line here is just a simple model, it's a toy model, just saying that what if we had a halo mass function and we populated by galaxies, but below a certain minimum mass, we only populate a fraction of those halos with galaxies, and we can easily reproduce this turnover here that occurs at a halo mass around 10 to the 8 solar masses, where these atomic ion cooling actually occurs. And this just came out a few months ago. I'm not an observer, so I think it's a new technique using wavelets to actually extend the luminosity function. I was amazed when I saw that. I first saw this in the conference about a year ago, I first saw these results. You know, redshift 8 going down to minus 15, going up to minus 15. At redshift 6, I didn't select this, but they went down to minus 13. But there's no sense of a turnover here. So I would only expect this. I would love to hear people's opinions on that here, because instead of source extraction, they use wavelets to actually to understand and isolate these sources and to reconstruct this luminosity function. And last, I want to end with some initial work that's being done by another one of my graduate students, Kirk Barrow. So he's actually, it's very important to actually correlate these physical properties of the galaxies to observations. Because when we start to observe these first galaxies, we want to know what we're actually looking at. So he takes the Renaissance simulations and takes the star particles and generates an intrinsic stellar spectrum, and then he uses cloudy to actually produce the nebular emission lines that are produced by inside these H2 regions, and then on top of that, extinction from dust. So dust is a very uncertain in the high redshift universe. Its composition is highly unknown, size, shape, distributions, and so on, but we could just take the drain models as a first stab at this and look at how much dust extinction we actually have. So he picked one for me to show that's a pretty extreme version. It's one of our most massive halos, 2 times 10 to 2 billion solar masses, has a stellar mass of 40 million solar masses. It's very metal rich. It's actually, I think it's in the process of creating all. If you look at the velocity, it's an outflow, so it's a transient feature of this galaxy in which these winds will be blown out. And it's forming stars at a very rapid pace. So the specific star formation rate is 40 per meteor. Right? So here is its density, its temperature, and its metallicity. But when he translates this into UV light, so here is its, if just take the resolution, the simulation resolution here, this is what you would expect in UV light. When you translate it into with 3 here in places of scouts, so this was actually taken at redshift 15, and well, we said, what if this, so we saw very little change in galaxy properties as a function of redshift, as long as it's forming in the neutral region. So we justified that by placing the galaxy at redshift 8.4. So this in the UV, this is right in the F140W filter. And what would it look like, right? It's a few pixels across. But our motivation is, this is a pretty small galaxy. What would it look like in your cam? And around the same redshift and filter. And what would it look like at redshift 12.5? And for this to be above the sensitivity, originally it just had noise, but I said, what if it was boosted by a factor of 10? Its magnification factor is boosted by a factor of 10. And this is the level of a few pixels across. This is a halo or a galaxy that has 40 million solar masses of stars. And this is what he's showing here is the intrinsic spectrum here. And because it's undergoing a lot of star in 1909 and is non-existent in this galaxy. I think it's probably obscured. There are other lines that are in the line, the Balmer series lines, and so on. And he's done a lot of emission, trying to look at any correlations in emission line strength and ratios in these galaxies to try to understand, you know, if we actually can measure these emission lines in these first galaxies, can we understand what are its star formation rates, its stellar star formation histories, its stellar mass, and so on. How can we tease out these physical properties instead of assuming some constant star formation rate or its exponentially increasing star formation rate, which is usually used in these stellar populations to fit the spectrum. Right? So, I mean, at very low mass, because you've got very bursty star formation, you're all over the place for a given star formation rate for both the strength, the equivalent width of O3, right? If you have an old stellar population, you have no more bursty regions. If you have a new, so these blue dots are new and young stars, right? New and massive stars being formed here, so you expect very, very strong O3 lines here. And I also asked him to look at these ratios of O3 to H beta. And he has other things, like looking at the UV, the rush frame UV, such as like the C3 line to the helium-2 line, and other diagnostics like that. Okay, so that is it. But things to think away are, I mean, population of three stars, and they kind of start organization, but I mean, they're important for affecting the protogalactic gas that then goes into forming the first galaxies. And they also enrich the first galaxies that then go on to produce these metal-enriched stars. Right? And they're important for its gas depletion because they form in a relatively gas-poor system, because those progenitors, those population three stars, have driven out all the gas, or most of the gas for that, and only a fraction of that falls back into the host halo. And these low luminosity galaxies have high escape fractions, but they're bursty as well, right? They may have high escape fractions, but they're only on for tens of millions of years before, you know, they can't form any more stars because there are no more gas. And also we found feedback effects to actually flatten the luminosity function above an AB magnitude of minus 14. And I'd be excited to see what the web finds from that. And, you know, I mean, it has to flatten at some point. We don't expect that luminosity function to diverge at very low luminosities. And that's it, and thank you for your attention.
Still in massive stars. It's just you have some of the stars as well.
Right.
So it doesn't
Yeah, because this is number.
Change that picture.
So this is number. So.
Well, you might not form the extremely like hundreds of seven mass things, but you're still going to form
massive stars.
Well, you're going to put most of your massive stars.
Yeah.
By number, you might have more red mass things.
What's it to follow up on this topic? One can use the abundance patterns of the extremely metrical stars in the galactic halo, or the bulge, and now also in some neighboring dwarf galaxies, and they all point towards core-colored supernovae. Do you think the masses that are inferred from the abundance patterns is 20, 30, at most 40 solar masses? So I think there is very little observational evidence for a few hundred solar masses.
I agree. There's one paper, I think it was Aoki, that saw that one weird abundance pattern. I wasn't really convinced because it didn't really matter because they had a stellar explosion model and they had the abundances overlap on it. And they're claiming parent stability, but it wasn't convincing to me. Yeah, that was one instance though. One star.
Should there is one discussion of course the parent stability, if you put rotation into your stars, it also shifts in mass down to the lower levels.
Yeah.
So I think this is from the point of the parent stability a wide open issue.
This power law and the luminosity function, which suddenly flattens off, and in your last slide also said it is due to the feedback process.
Right.
Could you explain this a little bit more?
It's feedback processes and star formation efficiencies. So in galaxies above this magnitude here, so we're in like low mass halos. So we have only a certain fraction of halos host young stars that then produce these UV photons.
And can one determine from theory the point where the
yes. halos are? So this corresponds to, we don't use that cutoff, so you can use the transition to atomic line cooling. So that's a barrel temperature of 10 to the 4 Kelvin. And that corresponds to around 10 to the 8 solar masses at pressure of 10 or so. So that's where roughly where this comes from.
Okay, is there another question?
So in your Renaissance simulation, you both have got two N properties stagnation,
yes.
right? So what prescriptions do you expect? So which IMF and which upper and lower mass?
Okay.
And how much do you trust them and how much would these change?
Yeah, so we use the IMF that we use is it's a power law at high mass and it turns over exponentially at 40 solar masses. And we consider 5 solar masses 300 solar masses. And we randomly sample from that. Now, how much does that change if we change the characteristic mass? I think it would change, it would change the metal enrichment a lot, I think. Because if you shift it from 40 to 20, you would have a much larger fraction going off of type 2 supernovae, rather than going into directly into black holes. So that's one limitation of writing these huge simulations. You would have to take something. And for that scenario, we have to take that and we have to see the scenario, what plays out, and then metal enrichment for that. For metal rich star formation, it's basically we search for, and once we have an overdense point, we search for molecular clouds and take 7% of that the cold gas in the molecular, or of the star forming cloud. It's not fully molecular. So above some density.
Okay, final question?
So I had a question about using the local dwarfs as objects to study dwarfs that are formed. How important is it in that analysis to assume, and do we know that the first stars in the local dwarfs actually formed during the epoch of reionization and not much later? If they form much later, are the glitches sufficiently different that maybe you cannot use them as analogs?
Well, recently, I think his name is Dan Weitz, he looked at the star formation histories of all the local dwarfs. In all of those dwarf galaxies, they have some amount of star formation at redshift 13 billion years ago or so. So if you have star formation going on back then, that means that you would have to have some metal 40 star forming before then. But you could have some late population 3 star that then creeps on or something. There could always be a late arrival or so. I'm interested in, I haven't really studied that, but how late can population 3 star formation actually occur? When do the actual voids become enriched with star or with metals? There have been studies with that. I personally don't trust them because they don't resolve many halos. So how can you address metal enrichment if you don't actually resolve the stars that are these population 3 stars? Yeah, it's very interesting.
Okay, so I would, there's one more question. Can I have one?
One question. What JWST observation would you most be excited about? Is it observing the flattening of the luminosity function or something else?
Oh man,
that's a
good question. So I have something personally I'd be very excited about, and for research, be very excited about. So for research, I think if we could actually I'm just looking forward to it actually, first light and observing stuff, but to actually pushing farther and farther into
shadow space for 15, 18, maybe 20? I don't know. But how far you get to that, but the farther you look away, the quality of the data goes way down. So it's not as spectacular. It's spectacular that it's so far away on the edge of the universe, but the quality of the data goes down. I mean, protoplanetary disks, I don't work on that, but I still find that amazing. Just like almost seeing those gaps in protoplanetary disks, I was blown away by that. If we can see that infrared thing, what?
So I think this actually is an interesting topic and a question, an interesting topic for dinner tonight. So let's thank our speaker again.